Sometimes. Being an expert in one scientific field does not translate to another. The ability to design a nuclear reactor does not make you qualified to dish out health advice, unless that advice is to avoid eating uranium. But if you're particularly clever, you might just find yourself making headlines for discoveries in multiple scientific fields. And today we're going to be talking about one such scientist, a particle physicist named Luis Alvarez, who investigated everything from atomic bombs to Egyptian pyramids to what actually killed the dinosaurs. Luis Alvarez was born in 1911, which put him in a great position to contribute to the newfangled field of particle physics. For example, that was the same year that Ernest Rutherford proposed an updated concept of an atom, where most of its mass is concentrated in a small, compact nucleus. But it was also 2 decades before we knew that nuclei didn't just have protons in them, but neutrons too. Alvarez got a PhD in physics from the University of Chicago before heading to UC Berkeley's radiation laboratory. And like any good scientist, he was constantly trying out new things and experimenting. So it's no surprise that he was soon pulled into one of the biggest science experiments in history. Life comes at you fast. And so did World War II. Alvarez started off working in the microwave radar space, but eventually he wound up at the hottest place for scientists in the early 1940s, Los Alamos, New Mexico, working on, you guessed it, the Manhattan Project. You probably remember from history class or from the movie Oppenheimer that the US dropped 2 nuclear bombs on Japan, but you might not remember that they were fundamentally different pieces of tech. Little Boy was a gun-type bomb powered by the element uranium. That means that in order to produce the necessary explosion, but only when you wanted to, one lump of uranium gets shot down a barrel super fast into another lump of uranium. This would get enough uranium atoms close enough together to achieve a runaway nuclear chain reaction whose immense energy cannot be contained by the stuff around it. But the Manhattan Project only had enough weapons-grade uranium for 1 gun-type bomb. So for the second nuke, Fat Man, they turned to plutonium. That element barely exists in nature, but it can be made in a nuclear reactor. There was a problem, though. Scientists quickly learned that the gun-type method would not work for plutonium. Basically, the plutonium bullet would detonate before it could get fired toward its target, preventing the really big boom the bomb makers wanted. Enter Alvarez, who showed up to Los Alamos in 1944. His job was to develop an implosion method for Fat Man. It was really complex, involving a spherical core of plutonium surrounded by high explosives. When those explosives were detonated, the resulting force would be directed inward, creating a shockwave that compressed the plutonium core. Just like with the uranium before, this would set off a perfectly timed runaway nuclear reaction, reversing the shockwave direction outwards into its surroundings. The results of Alvarez's work were obviously tragic, although unlike other Manhattan Project scientists, he never regretted them. His work on Fat Man solidified his science career, but other projects would be a bit tougher on his self-esteem. In the 1960s, Alvarez became fascinated with the Egyptian pyramids of Giza. Some had hidden chambers, but others didn't. Except, Alvarez was convinced they actually did. He was inspired by Geiger counters, electronic devices that detect and measure ionizing radiation, like the stuff produced when certain radioactive elements decay. His idea was to probe the inside of pyramids using short-lived subatomic particles called muons. They're similar to electrons, but over 200 times heavier. They're also created in abundance during atmospheric collisions with cosmic rays. In other words, they're everywhere. Muons can travel through solids like rock, although how likely they are to successfully make it through a bunch of solid rock depends on how much energy they have. But if a massive, supposedly solid object were hiding a secret room, Alvarez figured more muons would make it from one side of the object to the other and into your detector. He was certain that with the proper experimental setup, all those naturally occurring muons would help him unearth secret pyramid chambers. Spark chambers were super common detectors in particle physics at the time, creating high voltages between stacks of plates. As a particle passed through, you would see a spark. Alvarez came up with the idea of placing detectors in and around pyramids to measure muons as they passed through. He basically X-rayed a pyramid, specifically the pyramid of Khafre, the second largest in Egypt and one believed to have no chambers inside it. Now, Alvarez had reasons to feel cocky. In 1968, he won the Nobel Prize for his work with elementary particle physics. But what goes up must come down, including Alvarez's ego. His team counted over 1 million million muons and found that the center of the pyramid was solid. Alvarez said the results were the biggest surprise of his scientific life. He learned a lot about pyramid construction, and his work with muons would be super useful down the road for future scientific efforts. For example, in 2017, researchers announced they had used muons to find a hidden chamber in the pyramid of Khufu, which is right next door to Khafre's. That's a bit of a sliding doors moment for you. Like, which of these two pyramids right next to each other should I look at to test this groundbreaking new scientific technique? The one that will depress me at my failure, or the one that will actually discover something in 2017? The pyramids may have felt like a coming back down to Earth moment, but an actual coming to Earth moment wasn't far off. Remember, Alvarez was a physicist by training, so when his son Walter went into geology, he was baffled. Rocks? Really, Walter? Walt Alvarez became an expert on plate tectonics and mountain formation, with a big interest in the KT boundary, the geological layer that marks the end of the Cretaceous period and the beginning of the Tertiary period. Just so you know, eventually this would get renamed the KPG boundary, with the PG standing for Paleogene. Whatever you call it, this geologic boundary has loads of dinosaur fossils, suggesting a lot of them died off very quickly. But there was also an absence of limestone, which usually comes from bodies of tiny sea creatures. Walt got really curious about what might have caused all this, and eventually he reached out to his rock-indifferent dad. Luis, who I'm tempted to call Alvarez the Elder, soon grew curious about an external killer, something that could have come from space. A researcher named Malvin Rudderman had once suggested such a quick mass extinction could come at the hands of a supernova, a massive stellar explosion, assuming it was sufficiently close to our solar system, could have bathed our planet in enough radiation to destroy our protective ozone layer. In 1978, the father-son duo and other members tested rock samples from the ocean floor. They found 30 times more iridium than they'd expected. A supernova could have deposited a bunch of excess iridium, but it also would have delivered a particular kind of plutonium. And when they searched for an excess of that, they came up empty. But iridium can come from other things in space too, like asteroids. So if rocks in the KT boundary around the world had way more iridium in them, that could be a sign that a very large space rock crashed into the planet around the same time that most of the dinosaurs died. Alvarez the Elder ran the numbers and concluded an asteroid would eject debris and block out the sun, like at nuclear test sites. The team couldn't find an asteroid-sized crater to match, but they went ahead and published their findings in 1980. That was the year I was born. I remember this being a debate. It was like, people didn't know, and now it's pretty much settled. Paleontologists of the time hated this. The asteroid theory threw the scientific community into a tizzy, leading to years of back-and-forth fighting. In the midst of this scientific civil war, Luis Alvarez died of cancer. But in 1991, only 3 years later, researchers published their findings on the Chicxulub crater underneath Mexico's Yucatan Peninsula. And in 2010, a group of 41 scientists concluded the asteroid that created this crater also probably triggered the mass extinction of the dinosaurs. Sorry to all the paleontologists back then who disagreed, but the physicist-geologist duo won that round. But of course, you are free to take your skills, pull your own Luis Alvarez, and upend another field if you're able. And if you do, SciShow will get to cover your accomplishments as well. This video is inspired by a new book, Collisions, by Alec Nevala-Lee. It's a biography of Luis Alvarez, and tells the story of the many fields he revolutionized. If you'd like to check it out, you can head to the SciShow bookshop page. That's right, we have a bookshop page. There's so much good science writing out there, and we want to help promote it. This video is made possible by the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation.